So what is the criteria? You guys play poker professionally. You play a lot of live as well. I mean, mostly live, I guess, in this country at this point. What is the criteria? What are some fundamentals of a proper tournament? You know, it doesn't have to be perfect, for instance, but what are some things that you strongly care about?
A good tournament director is really all that matters. Okay. Everything else can be adjusted from there. But, like, another issue with Bellagio was we started with 40,000 chips, and it was, I don't know if you had the same issue, we were constantly changing chips. Because they gave us $5,000 chips, and mine's were only 1,500. And, I mean, it was just like, it slowed down the game so much. And, A, I didn't even want to go up to Jack and ask him to change the chips, because he probably wouldn't have even done it. But, like, how many times did they run this tournament? They should understand how to allot the chips, you know?
I took care of that situation at our table. I went to a person I know was friendly from the Highland area and asked him to give us a rack of black. And we gave him two 5K chips and took care of that. But I saw every table around us was having the same problem.
But that shouldn't be a problem.
Like, I mean, they should know from experience to plan ahead and test it in for others.
Yeah, I think this is good also for our listeners, many of whom, you know, play. Many of our listeners play poker. They like to play poker, but they will play it mostly recreationally. But they still like to play when they go to whatever casino. They like to have a good time, and they like to play, you know, proper poker, and they take the tournament seriously. So, you know, if you could illuminate us as to,
well, let's take standards. You know, be a good example. We could go on a positive note. We could say the best places to play, which probably right now the best tournament stop is the Epic Poker Tournament, which starts in 2 days. The way they treat players is like nothing else. Although it is unique in that they only have a certain group of players that are eligible to play. But what they do for the players right now is every player that's going to play in the Epic Poker event at the Palms is going to get 3 or 4 nights comped at the Palms, a nice room, $100 food credit each day. They get transportation to and from the airport. The actual tournament is run by Matt Savage, so, you know, we all know that he's the, you know, the most famous tournament director in the world, and there's a reason why everyone likes him. He handpicked all the dealers and the four people from all around the country that come for the Epic event. So we have the finest dealers and the four people. When you come to an Epic tournament, it was amazing. I mean, I remember it didn't take more than a half an hour on the first Epic tournament to realize, wow, these dealers are, I mean, the dealers and the four people, they just know what they're doing. It's such a pleasure for everything to be run so smoothly. And not every tournament stop can do that. That's a special thing because Epic is, has a different business model. It's not a rate-based business model. They're trying to attract big-name players. And, you know, all the other tournaments around the country are rate-based. So they have different incentives to do things for the players. But as far as the best place, the Epic's doing a standout job. And almost the Borgata, you don't hear any complaints from anybody when they go to Borgata for tournaments. The Tab and Stan Strickland, the program manager, takes care of the players. They get discounted rooms when they come for the tournaments, even when they're playing $300 events. The players seem real happy, and the room is the nicest room physically for people to play in. They have a huge arena where they put the tournament in upstairs, and they just keep the players happy. When players complain or players suggest to do different things for the next tournament, they listen. And they're willing to change things. And that's how they do it. And that's the same thing with Epic. And Annie's really listening to the players, and she's always seeking out advice from the players how to improve things. Mm-hmm. So there's just two different mindsets.
They're smart, and they realize that players are how they're going to make money. And if you don't appease the players, you're not going to make money.
It's called players first.
Yeah, exactly.
I would say Epic and Mercado are on one end, and then Foxwoods. It's certainly the other end of Bellagio. Hopefully it doesn't get to that point. They're not close to Fox, but it's not that. It's not as bad as Alan wants to make it seem. But
it's pretty bad.
But they should be less stubborn and try to work things out.
So there's going to be a rating scale, you know, on a scale from Fox was to Epic. How would you rate this tournament?
Interesting.
Let me bring up something that I wanted to ask you guys a little later, but bring it up right now. You guys, I want to ask you what you think about the Venetian poker room. The reason I bring that up is because you may have heard that the CEO of Las Vegas Sands Corporation, which includes the Venetian and Palazzo, Sheldon Adelson, has incurred the enmity and hostility of the greater poker community by saying he does not approve of online gaming, and he might get into the way of it, might get into the way of efforts. So people are saying, let's boycott, let's not play at the Venetian poker room. Again, now in my, I think it's, when I listen to some of these cries, I think, you know, not, maybe not most, but I think many of the people, you know, clamoring for this boycott are people who probably do not even play that much at Venetian anyway, and probably won't for a while. But what about you guys? I mean, you guys are professionals. How often do you find yourselves playing at the Venetian Poker Room? And would you consider either avoiding it completely as a statement, or maybe, you know, using what influence you have as professional poker players to register your complaints? And you talk about, you know, someone, a tournament director, or someone who listens to complaints and player feedback, registering your complaints or opinions with someone at the Venetian.
Well, I would say that I don't play there anyway. I've been there once for a charity tournament, I think Jen Harbin's charity tournament. I went there once for a private game during the World Series. Other than that, I've never really played there. So I couldn't say that I'm not going to go play there. It would really be it would be disingenuous to say that.
Mm-hmm.
But I would say the guy that is going to is running Venetian is he's looking out for the best interest of the Venetian. So I understand that. I don't hold that against him. You know, you have to be rational in these situations. That's his job. He's got a big time job. He gets paid a lot of money to defend their interests, and, mm-hmm. and that's what he's done.
Right. How do you feel about it?
I agree. I don't really play there either. I've played a couple of tournaments there, but I haven't played there in a long time. And, I mean, I agree. He's just doing his job, and he's protecting the casino and their interests.
So. Okay, he's protecting the casino, but would you not also say that that such a stance does not really benefit the poker community? I mean, you know, I hear you express so much anger against people like Mr. McClellan and such because they do not have the interests of the poker players at heart. They could run a very ruthlessly structured tournament that only benefited the casino, which I get the feeling that you might accuse them, and that's what they're doing. They're not keeping the players' considerations at heart. Instead, it's all about, you know, increasing rates or caches for the Bellagio. Do you not feel like holding out a similar resentment?
That's a little different because it's not like he's not looking. It's not like he doesn't care about the poker players that are in his poker room. He's just not looking for the general poker community, which isn't his job. Mm-hmm. You know, I mean, I'm sure he's still. Or, I don't even know what's going on, so I don't even know. I mean, you know, but, like, he's like CEO of the Sams or something?
Yes. Okay. And he's very powerful. Supposedly he has a lot of influence in Congress.
Right.
A lot of House Republicans, you know, he's a big donor. And it's kind of like if he calls up his friends in Washington and says, like John Kyle, actually John Kyle is a good friend of Mr. Anderson. If he says, don't make sure that that online gambling doesn't get approved, or it's
right.
You know, it's your ass, or it's, you know, I'm not writing this check next
right.
time. That might be an issue. So, you know, the poker community most invested in online poker anyway is upset. But don't you feel that a renewed or re-energized online poker environment in this country, what do you wonder is for the library as well?
There's no doubt.
Right.
Everyone agrees with that. I've never heard any different set of
well. I think it's easy to make that to say that now, but I remember because I was awake for 60 hours straight on Black Friday when it happened. We spoke to a lot of live players who actually, to them, it was almost a non-issue. I mean, it was weird. It was like, oh, this doesn't affect me. I'm a live player. Yeah, you know, it's, I don't play about online. I'm mostly a live player. I mean, but I was thinking, can't you think a little bit more three-dimensionally? Do you not see how this downfall will affect I like poker, but has it really though? Again, it's been 9 months.
It's a short term. You know, it, what you're talking about is more long term. It's going to bring more players to the game
mm-hmm.
From very small limits. People play 1 cent, 2 cent poker online where they don't want to do that live. But if they can do that online and grow their game to where they're comfortable, play a little bit bigger, and go to live casinos, that's how we grow the game. So you'll see the effect of not having online poker. You won't see the effect now, but we'll see the effect in a couple of years from now when those guys that would have been playing online poker for the first time this year
mm-hmm.
maybe would have stepped up to the casino poker in 3 or 4 years. You know, I think we'll see it going downhill by then if we don't pick up online poker by then.
I was thinking, I was talking yesterday, a couple of days ago, to Pete Godplein, Pete Lubrano. He's he's been hit hard by Black Friday. He used to play a lot online. Now he has to play live. He actually, I think he's from around your neck of the woods, thereabouts. He's from, I think he's in Brooklyn. I asked him, I said, you know, just 9 months ago, he was on the program frequently, just 9 months ago, we were all speculating, you know, oh my God, what is this going to do for the live arena? What is this going to do for the games that people play live? Are they going to get tougher, easier, unchanged? You know, you guys have played live, you're talking about playing cash and such. Anything noteworthy to report on that issue? Have you seen any significant changes? Can you tell that Black Friday happened?
I think the best online players have moved outside of the country temporarily to Canada, to Mexico, to Europe, and are still playing online. So it leaves us with the lesser successful pros online to come to the live games. So I think that's a good thing for someone like me. I think it's a good thing for the live games that the most successful online guys still would find it more profitable to be online, so they're forced to move out of the country. So as a short term, I think it's good for our type of games. Mm-hmm. But long term, we're going to need online poker to grow the game. Mm-hmm. It's not going to grow at any rate compared to where it used to grow based on just live poker.
Okay.
I actually play a lot of live no limit in casinos and some underground cash games. And I actually found that now there's like three or four young kids who I'm friends with that are now playing live no limit because they can't play online anymore.
Mm-hmm.
So it's kind of made the games worse. And in this one casino that I play in, there's a really good cash game. And now on certain days, there's like three or four young kids that are there all day because obviously they can't grind online.
Mm-hmm.
But I mean, I agree with Matt. You can't like... You know, back in the day, you used to deposit like $100 and you could run it up to like $5,000 online and you could build a bankroll and then start playing live.
Mm-hmm.
So, I mean, you can't really do that anymore in the U.S., so it's going to ruin the live game as well, you know, because... Oops.
Dirty look for you, Mr. Barron. Join me, Matt, please. Dirty. Okay, you know, I think I remember you telling us that you didn't play much online.
No, I did. I mean... Like, right before Black Friday, I think I was playing, like, 20 to 30 hours of 3060 Studied online. One of my best games.
He's a great Studied player.
Really?
Just ask him.
So, okay, but you don't... Perhaps you don't miss it as much as...
No, I mean, I don't miss it as much because I remember the negatives of it. I spent all day Sunday on my computer.
Mm-hmm.
Like, a lot of the time when I was spending time, like if me and my girlfriend were hanging out... And I was on my laptop, even if we weren't doing anything. Like, if I saw, like, a really juicy game, I couldn't help but hop in. And it would, you know, sometimes you're a slave to the game. If the games are good, you have to play. So it kind of took me off of a set schedule, whereas now I play, like, 2 or 3 days a week. I go play live no limit.
Mm-hmm.
And I know when I'm going to be gone for the most part. I know when I'm going to be back. So, I don't know. I mean, like I said, I definitely miss a lot of it. I miss on a random Friday or Saturday night if I'm like pre-gaming to go out or something and no one's at my apartment. I just like sit there drinking by myself and playing some heads up singles.
Drink and play.
Yeah.
Nice.
I mean, I wasn't like an alcoholic. I was just like, I was having a couple of drinks before I went out to the bars.
So. That's good.
But,
okay. So, but how is poker doing in this country? Because again, you know, you guys play it.
Right.
Again, that's also something we used to speculate on. Some people, some extremists were saying the Black Friday will destroy even live, you know, the devastation will spill over into the live arena. People are going to be culturally disconnected from poker. Fewer people are going to start playing it. That's just one doomsday scenario that was depicted. And you're right. It's been only 9 months. You know, it's been we need more time to really judge and assess what's been happening. And you're an honorable judge, so you're more than qualified to do it. But so, what is it like? You guys play on a consistent basis. What kinds of people do you meet? The people whom you meet, what kind of players are they? The people, you know, you play with the professionals whom you run into frequently. Do you run into the mass frequently?
Let me just say that this Bellagio tournament, this 10K, they had over 400 people.
Mm-hmm.
I haven't seen a 10K in a couple of years with more people that I didn't recognize. So that was a nice change.
Mm.
There was a lot of people new to the game or new to me in general, which is surprising, mm-hmm. that we're in a 10K. Would you say the same thing, Alan?
Yeah, I agree.
So that, I mean, I couldn't be more surprised in that area because basically it's the same people at all the tournament stops that you see all the time.
Mm-hmm.
So that was a good surprise. As far as what kind of people we may are playing with, Alan plays in our Gotti game somewhat frequently. We have a game every weekend where we're playing 300, 600 mixed. Usually starts at 300, 600. Try to keep it at that limit most weekends. It depends who shows up. Sometimes it's 2-4, sometimes 4-8, but 3-6 most of the time. We're playing a mix of all the horse games and no limit PLO, both with a cap, and then now we added a triple draw and Badoogie. So we have some draw games over there, so some of the guys from the West Coast were more comfortable coming over.
Mm-hmm.
And as far as the game, it's there are some professional players, but it's mostly a group of non-professional poker players playing there on a weekly basis. So we got doctors, we have restaurateurs, we have other businessmen, we have financially secure people that are retired and just want to play poker on the weekends. So it's a nice environment. And we have some winning tournament players that aren't so good at cash games come in the game. And some people would say that about me lately.
But it's funny because I hear you describe the scene as, you know, I mean, you of course have to judge it based on the profitability for you,
right,
and for you, you know. So of course, you know, an exodus of professionals and an influx of amateurs, for you, that's great. You have to be happy. You have to welcome that. But also there's a way of looking at the industry with perhaps a little bit more of a personal detachment and saying, well, you know, but judging it objectively, is indeed this exodus good for the game or good for the industry? And quite frankly, I'm not even really sure what I mean when I say it's something good or bad for the industry. I don't know. But I was hoping you guys could assist me with that. You know, what makes the industry, what makes the poker industry good? Is it, you know, recognition amongst, at least in this country, we're limited to this country. Is it a lot of people knowing about poker, playing it frequently in live casinos? How much does online poker play a component?
There's one thing that's more important to the industry than anything else, and it always will be, because of the way the game is set up, is growth. If you don't get new players to the game is not going to be as good over the long run.
Mm.
You have to have constant growth. It's the only way to keep poker booming. It's a game of Darwinism where only the best survive. So without new players, without new money coming in, it's not going to be a profitable game, even for the good professionals.
Mm.
So without growth, you really have nothing in poker. So everything has to be geared toward growth.
How do you encourage growth? Is there something you can do as a player? I mean, there's what media companies or media outlets can do. Like, you know, we try to tell people poker, 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 and then, you know, there's depictions and movies and TV, and there's promotions carried out by Caesars and all these gaming companies. What can players do?
It's hard for individual players to do anything to promote growth in the industry. You can promote growth in your own game, your own weekly game. You can promote growth in your casino. But basically, something like the Epic Poker League, where if this becomes successful, a lot of the top known professionals in the league, so I guess they have about 250 players that are eligible for the league. If they can present themselves in a positive light, present the Epic Poker League in a positive way when it's on TV and get national attention and kind of promote poker, think about while they're playing the events, to not only promote the league, to promote themselves, but also to promote poker, to put it in a positive light. That'll really help grow the game and make it more legitimate in people's eyes who don't know poker.
Mm.
And, you know, hopefully, I guess 5-6 years ago, if a kid went into poker when he was done college or dropped out of college, you know, almost 100% of parents were devastated and said, what is my kid doing with their life? What are they doing? So now it's gotten more accepted where maybe only half the parents are really upset when their kids are done college and now they're playing poker rather than getting a professional career. Hopefully we can change that where it becomes a very accepted profession and people actually, you know, admire it and think that, you know, maybe it's something that can be done professionally and, you know, is actually puts out. You're kind of sort of like an entertainer as a poker player.
Mm-hmm.
That's the way I look at it. And you have to present yourself and the game you're playing in a positive light. That's the most important thing. Mm-hmm. If everyone thinks that way, it'll help poker grow.
So I would never want my kid to play poker for long. Personally.
Is that right? Well, what was your parents' reaction to it?
They were... I mean, when I was working at Morgan Stanley, I probably was making around the same playing poker part-time as I was as I was at that job. So they understood that there was more to me, but my mom was kind of skeptical at first. She didn't really understand the skill aspect of it. And even after my first year, I grossed something like $850,000 to $1 million playing tournaments. But she still was like, "Oh, well, you know, you never know. Like, you could run bad the next year." She didn't say run bad, but I think now she's understood that, you know, there's a lot of skill to it, because I'm friends with Jason, and even though she always says that he's just like the luckiest player ever, she understands that he's good. And Eric Seidel is crushing. So, I mean, even though that's all variance, they are good players, but no one should be winning as much as they are. You know, a parent has no choice but to understand the skill aspect of it.
Well, then why do you say that you would never want your kid to play poker?
Because it's miserable. I mean, like, the lifestyle is miserable. You're around miserable people a lot of the time. I mean, I would say that I like a lot of the people in poker, but a lot of them I wouldn't be friends with if I wasn't if we didn't play poker together.
Mm.
Not you. You. I'd be friends with you, I swear. But but in reality, we probably wouldn't even met each other, me and Macklin. So I mean, there's a lot of good things to poker. But besides that, it's just like I go to Europe, okay, and I'm 27. You know, relative to the European poker scene, I'm not really that young. And, I'll be honest, I have a very good social life outside of poker. I have a lot of friends back home. I drink on the weekends, you know, I have a good time, whatever. But then you, go to these poker stops, and I'm going to poker stops because I want to play poker. You know, I'm trying to make money, I'm trying to make a living. But a lot of these kids, they have a lot of money, and they just start drinking and acting like fools, even though I act like a fool when I'm drunk sometimes. But it's just, annoying to hang out with them, because they're, 18 to 20-year-olds, and they're just degenerates, and they gamble and everything, and you can't go to dinner without credit card rouletting, and it's, just the whole lifestyle, it can get a little out of hand at times. And
Much of that is an age thing, though, you know?
Yeah, of course, but, I love Epic, I love the Palms, but right now the Palms has, a food court that has zero healthy meals that I can, the healthiest option is McDonald's. It really is. I think McDonald's is probably healthy. There's a lot of things on the menu that are healthier than Nathan's or the pizza place, you know? Mm-hmm. And it's how am I supposed to eat healthy living at the Palms?
Right.
You know, and that's just how it is in general. Like, when you're traveling all over the place, you don't have time to have a healthy meal.
Yeah.
Let alone eat. Sometimes there are days where I don't even eat because, you know, I'm playing a tournament. There's, what are you smiling at?
Somebody's typing something in the chat.
What?
Someone typed.
What did they say?
Do you play other poker games besides Hold'em, and how could they run?
I do play other games that I don't run very well. That's the.
I don't know if they're talking to you, but that's funny. So, but anyway, so what I think about poker is it gives the opportunity to young kids that are single that choose to either drop out of school, which I would never recommend, or wait till they're done school and play poker. Gives them an opportunity, if they're traveling the tournament circuit, to travel the world and see the world for a few years. You know, even if they're not going to make poker a career choice, even if they can do it profitably or even break in for a few years, that's a nice experience. I mean, I wasn't given that option when I was that age. I didn't play poker at that age. So, you know, I'm married with a family. I don't have that ability to travel the world and do that kind of fun stuff. But if I was, you know, 24 years old and single, I would love to do that.
Right.
And it's a great opportunity. There's not many other careers where you can do that.
But how many players really take advantage of that? Because, I agree. If I had the chance to go to all these places in Europe and you know, wherever else we go, even just in this country, Asia, South America, I'd probably just put aside a couple of extra days for just sightseeing. You know, I don't know how much of that I see that, though.
Do you want to know what the percentage of poker players that set aside a couple of days to sightseeing?
Is it low?
Probably less than 0.1%.
Less than 0.1%?
I would say 10%. There are guys that actually do it.
I'll take the under on 10%. Jason Mercer, one of my close friends, he's probably traveled to more countries than probably any other poker player. Or he's seen a whole bunch of poker stops, and this is exactly what he does. He sits in his hotel room, he plays a tournament, he busts out, he goes and eats somewhere right next to his hotel room, and then he goes to his hotel, back to his hotel room.
And then the next day, poker.
Yeah, probably plays online poker.
Wow.
And, you know, he's got a lot of money to sightsee. And I honestly can't remember a single stop where he's seen, like, the city at all. We've been to San Remo. He's been to San Remo probably 3 or 4 times. And I don't think he's ever seen San Remo.
He's too busy making money.
See, that's unfortunate because that I think that could also be upheld as some kind of educational advantage.
Yeah,
imagine if you found some 21-year-old
sure.
kid who's just like, oh, look at all the cool places I'm going to, and here is where Western civilization was birthed in Greece, or something like that.
There are some poker players that get into that, that go and travel around and really make it worthwhile.
Not many. I don't know many.
Well, where was the last trip you took, poker or otherwise?
The last is right here. The last one before this was Jacksonville.
Okay, but like where?
I don't go. I've been to Europe one time in my life.
Like I mean, like a touristy kind of let's take photographs and soak up the local flavor.
I guess Bahamas, Atlantis probably doesn't count either, right?
What doesn't?
Atlantis, Bahamas.
Nah, that's a beautiful place.
No, it's not
a beautiful place.
It's a beautiful beach, beautiful resort.
It's overpriced.
But I've been there 6 out of the last 7 years with my kids and my wife, and we've always had a great time. It's
mm-hmm.
a nice time.
Mm-hmm.
But there's not, I don't really go to these spots. I'm talking about spots in Europe and mm-hmm. Asia where these kids go to poker tournaments. They have an opportunity to see things. So it's up to them if they want to take that opportunity or not.
Well, didn't you say recently that you were trying to get out of poker a little bit and into more of what Matt used to do? Trading or...
No,
he didn't.
I definitely said I want to get out of poker, but I don't ever want to get back. I was never a trader. I did bullshit at Morgan Stanley.
Okay.
I did Excel spreadsheets. Yeah, I mean, I still am planning on getting out of traveling the tournament circuit.
Mm-hmm.
I think that is my intention. I want to get into some other businesses in New Jersey that I'm looking into and play cash.
Mm-hmm.
It's pretty tough not to just stay at home when I can play. I play poker 2 or 3 days a week, and I make like $4,000 or $5,000 a week playing live no limit.
Mm-hmm.
And it's pretty low variance, and it's like, I'm not going to make $1 million a year doing that,
right.
But at this point I understand what poker can give me and what it can't give me. And I know that I won't be a multimillionaire from poker, but I think that I can be a multimillionaire from other stuff.
Okay.
So.
Well, good luck with that.
Thank you. Yeah. I mean, it's tough not to play tournaments when you see the top tournament players play in the tournaments that you're playing. They just make like so many mistakes. It's just absurd. But
we can get into that. But there's something. But isn't that kind of like what he just said? Isn't that kind of like the opposite of your story? Weren't you a trader? You were working outside of poker, and then you just
yeah.
dived right into
it. I was an options trader on the Philadelphia Stock Exchange.
Right.
I had guys trading for me there in three other big stock exchange cities: New York, Chicago, and San Francisco, and. Things kind of dried up for me there, and I wanted to try poker for a year
mm-hmm.
after trading, so I tried poker, kind of set a goal in mind with my wife, and we said, we'll see if I can make this certain amount of money in the first year of poker. If I can, we'll try for another year. If not, I'll go back to the stock exchange and
mm-hmm.
go back to my original career, but I want to try something new, and I found it. I love it. I've been doing it for, I guess, 8 years now, and it's been pretty good. Really, this is the first year where I decided pretty much that I'm going to make a career out of poker, not just year by year, but I'm going to put everything I can into poker.
Mm-hmm.
And that's why you see my website coming out recently. And, you know, it ties into what you said, what can one poker player do to promote the game or promote growth in the game? And one thing I'm trying to do is my goal for 2012, and I've made... started making this public recently, is really to get the mindset of the poker players that I know, and I know almost all the top professionals. Um.